Well, hello, good morning. Once again, welcome to Whispering Hope Daily Lesson Study. And here I have with me this morning, Dr. Wayne Knowles, Executive Secretary of the South Leeward Conference. Good morning, Dr. Knowles, and how are you this morning?
Good morning. It's good to be here, and I'm doing great. Just giving God thanks for life.
Thank you. This morning, as we go into our lesson, we're looking at this week, Indestructible Hope. What a topic. I found that a rather interesting topic. But today's topic, we're looking at our Father's discipline. Our Father's discipline. But before we go into our study today, I'm going to invite Pastor Wayne Knowles to invite God's presence and blessing on this study this morning. And then we move right into our memory text, then we'll go into our lesson for today.
Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity to be here again. We thank you for your word that have been put in a lesson study format. As we dive into this study today, I ask that you'll be with each of us, open up our minds. May your Holy Spirit guide us into all truth, and may this study be a blessing to each and every one of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our memory text is, now hope does not disappoint because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who has given to us. Romans chapter 5 and verse 5. So before we go into our lesson fully this morning, Pastor Knowles, could you give us an understanding of what our memory text is saying to us for this week?
Well, yes, it speaks to hope. And we know the Bible says also that we're saved by hope. The hope that Christ brings to us comes with an assurance. And the assurance mentioned in this text here is that it really does not disappoint. What we place our hope in, as far as Christ is concerned, will come to pass. We hope that when we die in Christ, we'll be raised again. We hope that when we abandon the things of this world, we will gain more on the other side. We hope that one day Jesus will come again and take us home to be with him. We hope that one day this earth will be made all new. And Apostle Paul is saying, hope does not disappoint. And he gave a reason. Because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. So wherever the Spirit of God is, hope will be sprung to life. And if God is in the midst of it and God says anything, it bound to must happen. So we can rest assured that whatever God has promised, we can have place our hope and anchor our hope in him.
Pastor Knowles, we move on this morning. And I'm going to ask you to read Hebrews chapter 12, verses 5 through to 13.
All right, so we're looking at Hebrews chapter 12, 5 to 13, and I'm reading from the New King James Version. It says, and you have forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as to sons. My son, do not despise the chastising of the Lord, nor be discouraged when you are rebuked by him. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens and scourges every son whom he receives. If you endure chastening, God deals with you as he with sons. For what son is there whom a father does not chasten? But if you are without chastening, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate and not sons. Furthermore, we have had human fathers who corrected us, and we pay them respect. Shall we not much more readily be in subjection to the Father of spirits and live? For they indeed for a few days chastened us as seemed best to them. But he for our profit, that we may be partakers of his holiness. Now, no chastening seems to be joyful for the present, but painful. Nevertheless, after it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. So nevertheless, afterward, it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained. Strengthen the hands which hang down and the feeble knees, and make straight paths for your feet, so that what is lame may not be dislocated, but rather be healed.
Dr. Knowles, we looked at this text this morning, and the lesson from that, what's the message to us here, and how does it fit in with what we have been studying this quarter? And you know, we have been studying about the crucibles and the various challenges that we go through from time to time. Each of us have differing trials and testing, but we all go through testing and crucibles. So in the light of that, how does this message apply to us? What is the message Paul is sending to us today?
Well, our topic for today is quite fitting. It covers it well, our Father's discipline. Sometimes when we go through trials, we do not see the hand of God in it. And so when we look through this, the word traced in here also means discipline. And that's the primary use that this lesson is taking of the Greek word. And some of the translations don't use chastening, they use the more modern word discipline. So when we look at what the Apostle Paul is saying in the book of Hebrews chapter 12, he's basically pointing to the fact that if we belong to a parent, they will discipline us. We may not enjoy it, but the fruit of it makes us better. When we see the result of it, we say hallelujah. I've oftentimes heard persons say, well, if I didn't get all them blows, if I didn't have to carry all that bucket of water, if I didn't have to wake up early and go get the cows in the pasture, all that's part of the discipline. It's part of the hard knocks that we go through in life, and the parents had a purpose for it, is to teach us responsibility. So it helped to discipline us to become nurtured, in the way that we can become mature adults, successful adults. Likewise, Paul is saying, if the earthly fathers can do that and the results are positive, how much more our Heavenly Father, who put us through the mill so that we can come out as more fitting, and he calls us righteous, as he would want us to be.
Okay, so Pastor, we're going to take a short break. And yes, we'll be right back. And when we get back, we're going to take a more introspective and bird's eye view of Hebrews chapter 1 through to verse 13, so that we can ask a more definitive question and bring out more specifically what it is saying to you and to the rest of us who are following this morning on Whispering Hope.
Okay, wonderful.
Keep you near the cross, and may your troubles show that you need God, and may your battles in the way they should, and may your bad days.
We're back, and we're going to look at the first four verses of Hebrews, and we're going to tie it with verses 5 to 13 that was already read by Pastor Knowles, and then we'll ask him some specific questions this morning. Paul says in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, wherefore seeing we also are compassed with so great a cloud of witness, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him that endures such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. Ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. And my first question to you now, Dr. Knowles, looking at the entire passage of Hebrews 1 through to verse 12, what is the source of discipline?
Well, the trials that we go through are the source of discipline. And what I would say is that these difficult times that we go through are generally because of a relationship with Christ. So if you notice, verse 1 speaks about the cloud of witnesses, not the crowd of witnesses, because the crowd do not necessarily participate in the trial, they're just onlookers. But the cloud are those who have been successful, so they're now above looking down. That's the imagery that is painted here. So they would have gone through trials and difficulties because of our faith, because chapter 12 verse 1 connects with, talks about those who went through by faith, whose trials came by faith. So when we look at the source of our discipline, the source of our discipline are the trials we go through because of our faith. And these trials are there to help discipline us, to strengthen our faith. So the trials are the source of our discipline.
Particular question in the lesson this week asks, what is our response to discipline? But that would speak to both you and I. But I wanted to, and for the others who are listening, they can include themselves. So I would put it another way. And what should be our response towards the discipline?
Well, we should endure it. Several of the verses speak to that. It even speaks of Christ enduring. Verse 2 speaks to that. Verse 1 speaks to the cloud of witnesses enduring the hardship. So that's the attitude we should have. We should endure. And when we get to verse 9, the Bible says, "For we have had human fathers who corrected us, and we paid them respect. Shall we not much more readily be in subjection to the Father of spirits and life?" So we should be submissive to the chastening that God gives to us because of our faith. You know, sometimes we don't want the challenges. And I remember just last week I visited a person who wants to get baptized, but without the test of faith, which is the Sabbath. And the person who introduced me to the individual said, "You know, this person needs a letter for Sabbath off." I said, "No, they need to make a sacrifice. Then the letter can come after they would have accepted Christ, gotten baptized," because the decision shouldn't be based on a letter, right? Whether they get Sabbath off or not. Seasoned Bible worker couldn't understand it. I said, "Bro, the reality is, if we give this person a letter so they can keep the Sabbath, then we would have prevented them from exercising their faith. So after you exercise your faith, we affirm it by saying this person has confirmed through their baptism that they have accepted Christ and willing to go all the way, make all the sacrifices. Can you please, you know, honor this person's faith by giving them the Sabbath off?" So sometimes we try to pull people out of the trial and not realizing that we're doing worse for them, because the test of faith is meant to make us better and more righteous in Christ.
Absolutely, absolutely, Pastor. And as you made that point, it is that we make the decision knowing that God is able to provide. He's able to fulfill what he says he will do. I don't say, "Well, I'm going to wait here, and if God can provide me with a house, with a family that really loves me and take care of me, I'll give my life to him someday." No, I'm going to give my life to him. And then I'm going to trust him to fulfill that all that he has promised to me. And that leads us into our next question, where it asks, what is our goal? What is the goal of discipline? So now, the discipline, as seen here, what is the goal?
Verse 11, I think that speaks very well to it, of Hebrews chapter 12. It says, "Now no chastening seems to be joyful to the present, but painful. Nevertheless, afterward it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. So righteousness is the result. Having that right relationship with God is what the result would be. So you're strengthened in your faith when the tests and the trials come because of your relationship with Christ. Your faith is strengthened. And to have that peaceable, I like the way the author puts it, not just righteousness, but peaceable fruit of righteousness. So that means that we are at peace with God. That's the peace that matters most. We may not always find peace among men, but peace with God is the ultimate peace that we have. So the righteousness that the trials bring puts us at peace with God. So we're in right standing with Him. We're not at war with Him. We are in a happy relationship with Him. The world around us falling apart. I'm losing my hand. I'm losing my eye. I'm thrown in prison because of my faith. But I'm at peace with God because it is His righteousness that makes the difference in the long run.
Yes. Oh, Dr. Knowles, I always like to put myself in other people's shoe. And as I'm sitting here and you're answering so eloquently, I'm thinking the way of the transgressor is hard. That's what the Bible says.
It says
then if the way of the transgressor is hard, then the way of those who seek to be obedient to God's will should be easy. Then why, O crucible, why the discipline that we are being put through?
Well, it gets easier. It's not that it's not difficult, because when you start to ride a bicycle, you fall off, you bust your face, and all these things happen. But the more you ride the bicycle, the better you get at it. So it's not that it's a difficult thing, but you get better at it as you continue to build a faith in Christ. And same thing like weightlifting, or if you never ran for a while and you run a half marathon, your muscles are going to be painful. But the more you run it, the same difficult track, your journey becomes easier. Not that it's an easier journey, but because you're strengthened, you're better prepared for the journey. And that's what the crucibles do. The crucibles strengthen us for any trial and difficulty that may come. So it's not that they're not difficult. It's just that we're more prepared to handle them. Our faith is stronger. Our faith is anchored in God. And so no matter the trials, the greater the faith, the better we're able to face the trials of life. So these difficulties come because of our faith to make us stronger in faith in God.
Dr. Knowles, it says in paragraph 2 of today's lesson, throughout Hebrews 11, Paul has been painting pictures of men and women of faith. Their faith was what kept them going when they were faced with all sorts of trying situations. What really developed the faith? Because the faith is what keeps them going, but something must have developed the faith. I don't seem to see what Paul is saying that brings that faith to that level of maturity where they can now exercise it. Could you shed some light on what helps to grow or develop our faith?
Yeah, it goes back to our trials, our faith tested to make us stronger. And in the Hall of Faith in chapter 11, each person's trial was different. Each difficulty was different. So what may be a trial for me may not be a trial for you. And so every one of these persons in the Hall of Faith listed, they had different trials and tribulations. We see with Daniel, with David, with Abraham, with Rahab, every single one had a different trial. So you may look at me and say, okay, I'm looking strong, but you may not know that my trial is on the other side that you're not seeing, because you're looking at what would satisfy you, or maybe you're measuring me by the struggle you are having. And so sometimes it's important to recognize that our trials are different, and it is our trials that help to build our faith. Because here's what happened. When we go through difficult times that are bigger than us, we have someone to turn to, and that is God. When we learn to trust Him in the difficult times, we now develop a sense of confidence in God that we never had before because of the experience that we have. So each experience should strengthen our faith in God.
Thank you very much, Pastor. We are going to take a short break again. And after we have looked at what really strengthens our faith and how important are crucibles in our life, or the discipline, the source of discipline in our life, we are now going to look at personal reflection and life application when we get back.
I've had many tears and sorrows, had questions for tomorrow. There have been times I didn't know right from wrong. But in every situation, God gave blessed consolation that my trials come to only make me strong.
Okay, welcome back, Dr. Knowles, and welcome back to our viewing audience. The lesson asks us as we go through Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 to 13, and I want you to do that. It says, make a list of all the reasons you can identify as grounds for your hope. So I hope that you're doing that this morning as you follow us this morning and we're studying the lesson. If you saw any items that popped out at you that strengthened your hopes or your ground for hope, you can just put it in the chat there as I reason along with Dr. Knowles this morning as we come up with our list and we share with you, and we hope that you'll go as you listen to us. Dr. Knowles, I don't know if you got an opportunity to create a short list.
Well, yeah, emphasis is on short because when we go through scripture, there are different things that help us in our faith walk with Christ. I look at Bible characters from time to time, and I look at Jesus' relationship with various Bible characters, and this tend to give me grounds for my hope. The first one is how God dealt with Adam and Eve at the point when they sinned. And if God could have left heaven to come to earth and have a mingling conversation with Adam and Eve, he didn't stay up heaven and shout down at them and so on. He came right where they were and had that conversation. That gives me grounds for hope because I'm chief of sinner. And so that was so important for me. Also, when I look at Moses is one of my favorite Bible characters. When I saw how Moses abandoned his people and how God met him one day and never left him until he said yes to be a deliverer, someone who had no interest in going back, God was able to work with him. And it shows me that sometimes we do not start at 100, we start at a 0, you know, and God just stays with us like that bloodhound. He not letting us go. He works with us. All the questions and excuses, Moses made 5 critical excuses why he can't be the one, but God didn't take him on, and God answered his questions. He was just there with him, and that gives me grounds for hope that though I'm not perfect, God is able to work with me as a leader to do great and mighty things. And the third and final one I'll mention is what happened when Christ came. When Christ came upon the earth, just the fact that God didn't just come down as he did with Adam and Eve and gave them a plan, not just come to Moses and made him a deliverer so the people can leave Egypt. God actually came down in the form of man. He took on human flesh. He came to suffer among us, and he came to experience in a physical sense, not in a sinful sense, but in a physical sense, what we go through in a sinful world as human beings. And then he sacrificed his life for me. That's grounds for my hope. And if God could do that, it means that there's nothing else that he would not do for me. He risked it all so that I can be saved. So these three examples I pull out for me are critical for me resting my hope in who God is and what he has done for me.
Pastor, you pulled out one of mine. I would have chosen Moses. But since you chose Moses, I'll go with Peter.
I'm glad you're choosing something else.
Yes, Peter, a short-tempered, loose-mouthed guy who God was able to use and to do so much mighty works with. I always see that as a source of hope. Paul, too, when you looked at his life, is a source of hope for me. But then when I like to look at David, and I used to think that David could have been the most probably quote-unquote despicable character in the Bible, being a man of God, chosen by God at an early age, and turned out to be an adulterer and a murderer, and still found favor with God. And then I looked at who I would consider the most challenging character in the Bible for me, a man called Samson. And if God could have listened when Samson said to him, just one more time, God, this time, and I will be able to fulfill what you have set out to accomplish through me. And God was there to hear and answer Samson's prayer. I have hope that this is a faithful God. And so those are my four characters, Pastor. I think when I look at them, the more I study them, the more my faith becomes stronger in knowing that God is going to fulfill what he has promised to me.
Amen, amen. Wonderful. And God is that good that we could have chosen 100, eh?
Yes, God is good. Certainly, certainly. And the question now, Pastor, that we close with today is, how have you experienced this hope in your own time of spiritual education?
Well, that's all we have. We're saved by hope, according to the author of Corinthians. We're saved by hope. And God gives us hope in that these experiences have been the testimony of many before me, that they too trusted in these experiences that were shared. And for me personally, that's what I've done as well. I have allowed the spiritual experiences of others that you have shared, that we find in the scripture, to be an educational process to me, to teach me about God, to teach me about myself, and to help me to anchor my faith in him. And that's why my favorite song, well, one of the few, 522, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. So that's what that spiritual education has done for me.
Absolutely, absolutely. And friends, as we close this morning, I must have met persons in my lifetime who have said, I have done so many detestable things in life, there is no hope for me. I've actually had persons say that to me, and I've tried to use these same Bible characters to say, you could not have done more than what these gentlemen have done. Moses, a murderer. David, a murderer. Samson, an adulterer. Or he chose a wife who God forbid him not to choose. Mm-hmm. He went into the house of ill repute. Paul persecuted God's people. And Peter was a swearword man. Mm-hmm. But yet all these persons found grace in the eyes of the Lord.
Yes.
And this morning, it doesn't matter what you have done, what you might have done, you can find grace in the eyes of the Lord. Whatever you have been through, God was preparing you for this moment so that you could hear this word and understand that he cares for you.
Amen.
God bless you. Have a wonderful day, because there is a hope, a glorious hope, a blessed hope that you can believe in.